These are some general things to get you thinking the right direction, to be thinking the direction of survival and accomplishing, getting to another location, getting to a safer place. Hi, I'm Doug Berry. Welcome to this video. I appreciate you being with me. I am the founder and director of Battle Ready. Battle Ready's mission has always been to help you be better prepared for the fight, the battle, the struggle, the conflict, the crisis, whatever situation you're dealing with, body, mind, and soul. Today, we're going to talk about putting together a bug out bag, go bag, a get home bag. People call it different names. Basically, what it is having a bag with you, keeping it in your vehicle for the most part. You might bring it in your house, but having a bag with you that has basic items in it that allow you for at least a day, two, or up to 3 days in general to cover five basic categories: shelter, water, food, defense, and medical. Those five main categories, you can break it down a little more from there, but those five main categories are what we want to address on a regular basis and make sure that we've got them covered, especially if there's an emergency of some sort that we're struck with. Maybe you're stranded on the side of a road due to a car that breaks down, your engine breaks down, or you get a flat tire, maybe you got a weather condition you got to deal with, or maybe you've got something even more extreme and serious, from natural disaster to civil unrest. A bag like this gives you the basics that you need to cover, again, those five major categories: shelter, water, food, medical, and defense. And check the link below for a full checklist of everything, all the gear that we're talking about here. The first thing that we need to address is the type of bag you're going to carry your gear in. There are a variety of bags on the market. Without question, you can go with something that's much larger, something that's more of a camping bag. It gives you a nice distribution of weight. They're built, these rigs are built to distribute it nicely so it doesn't sag in the lower part of your back and affect you if you've got to walk over long distances. You also have something as simple as a $10, $12 bag from a local department store. Simple, small, easy. Somebody might carry books into to school, to go to school, to library. It's a simple little bag and it's very discreet. Now that's something to consider as well. You can go with something that's more of a tactical looking bag, like so. You can even get them in OD green and camouflage. But those are going to stand out a bit more. And if you end up in a situation where you've got a civil unrest in your streets and you've got to move through the streets and you want to be a little less conspicuous, you don't want to walk through the streets looking like you're all decked out military, ready for war, that can draw some unnecessary attention. You want to be more what's called the gray man, where you're kind of blending in. A bag like this might work better that way. So based on your budget, what you can handle, what you can afford, that's going to determine obviously a lot of what you get. But whether it's the bag that you get or any of the equipment that we talk about here, I will say this. It is good to get the best that you can get. You don't have to get Cadillac level, but you want to get good quality stuff. You want to get good quality gear, especially considering your life may depend on some of this stuff. But you don't want to buy stuff that's cheap. You want to buy a bag where the handles are going to rip and the straps are going to come off when you're hiking 10, 15 miles. You don't want to be in a situation like that. So try to buy good quality stuff based on what your budget will allow. Let's address shelter first. You want to make sure that you are protected from any inclement weather, elements in general. There's an old saying out there, if you're going to be out there long enough, it's not a matter of if you're going to get wet, it's when you're going to get wet. So one of the first things I'm going to recommend is that you have something to keep you dry. Having a good waterproof jacket on hand is essential. Not to mention a poncho. This rolled up, obviously, poncho with a hood here. This is important too. You're probably, again, going to get wet. You want to keep dry. Having a tarp on hand is a good idea. This is a 5x7 foot tarp, nice tightly rolled up here. You might be wondering, what can you do with a tarp? Well, if you're gonna have to camp out, if you're gonna have to sleep out on the ground, this could be something you're gonna lay underneath you to provide some protection from the ground, moisture in the ground, whatever else you have to deal with, or you stretch it out over your head and create some sort of a tent, some sort of an awning, some sort of a cover from either the sun or rain. Combine that with some rope and paracord. Great things you can do with a tarp and rope and paracord. You've got to keep your hands safe. Having extra gloves on hand is important. Many problems can occur from simply cuts and scrapes. Obviously, lacerations or more serious wounds are a problem. You're going to have a med kit, I hope. We're going to address that in a moment here. But having gloves to keep your hands from getting those cuts, those scrapes, is going to save you so much time and so many more problems. So having gloves on hand, and not just one pair, I recommend having a couple pair at least. I do believe in the redundancy rule of two is one is none. In fact, you want to have more than two, that's great. When it comes to things like gloves, when it comes to things in your med kit, when it comes to things like fire, water, the basics in general, having more than one is a very, very good idea. I've got a variety of blades, knives here for all types of situations. I've got a survival hatchet. I've got a Gerber multi-tool pair of pliers on it. It's going to have a knife in here. It's going to have a couple different types of screwdrivers. A small saw is going to be in here. These types of tools are important for a variety of things, especially in a survival scenario. I've got a good heavy-duty Schrade survival knife. This can be used for chopping wood. I've used this to cut down small 2-3 inch diameter trees. It can be used for splitting wood, for a variety of other things. You want to have a good sheath on it, and you want to have a way to retain it to your body, to strap it to your body, put it on a belt, tie it to your leg. I've also got a small mini machete made by Camillus. It's got a nice serrated edge here for sawing, a variety of things you can do with a tool like this. And again, it's got a way to retain it through a belt loop here and attach it to your body. I also encourage you keep a small pry bar. Variety of things you can do with a pry bar. Obviously, it's small, it's compact, good hardened steel, able to be used in a variety of situations. Duct tape has hundreds of uses. There's so many things you can use it for. It's just one of those items that you just want to have on hand because you don't know what you're going to be up against. It's one of those items you can use for a variety of different things. And as with many of the things that I'm talking about here, the goal here again is to start thinking the direction of how can I improvise and adapt depending upon the circumstances I find myself in with what I have on hand in order to accomplish the goal. And the goal may be I've got to walk home and it's a 10-mile walk. I'm going to be home in a few hours. Or it's got to be I've got to move through town and there's civil unrest. Now I've got to do it in a different way. Or I've got to spend several days out in the woods trying to hide out or just cross some rugged terrain. The goal is to have items that allow you to accomplish that. Duct tape, paracord, a tarp, these types of items are those types of things just to have because you can use them to improvise and adapt in a variety of situations. A bandana is another one I recommend. Bandanas are good for a variety of things. You might think, well, what am I going to use it for? You're going to use it to cover your face, maybe in a situation where you need some sort of cover. You're going to use it maybe to keep the sun off of your neck. You're going to use it maybe to wrap up a wound. Another great item to have with you in the same category as duct tape, meaning that you might not know exactly what you're going to use it for when you put it in your bag, until you get in a situation where you need something like this, is zip ties. They'd be used for a variety of different things. Obviously, they're lightweight, they're inexpensive, and doesn't take up much space in your bag. Now, I'm holding these together with these little straps of bike inner tube. Why a bike inner tube? Cut into little slices like this. They make great kind of glorified rubber bands, if you want to call it that. I've also got larger ones from a car inner tube. Now, regular rubber bands over time are going to dry out. Right? And you're going to strap things together and you want to be able to tie things down, restrain things, retain things. Rubber bands are helpful, but over time they will dry out. They'll lose their elasticity. Inner tubes are different. They handle things a lot longer and they retain their elasticity. Also, when it comes to shelter, you want to keep emergency blankets, these very thin foil-like emergency blankets. They do a great job in retaining some heat. And they're good to have for a variety of purposes. They're small, they're compact, they're lightweight, they fit very easily in bags. Also want to recommend having plastic garbage bags with you, heavy-duty plastic garbage bags. There are some survivalists who will swear that if you could pick one main thing to be able to survive in inclement weather, a plastic garbage bag. You can do a lot of things with it for protection, for shelter. You can use it to help catch water if you need water. For drinking, there's a variety of things you can do with a plastic garbage bag. One of the most important items you have to have on hand is the ability to start fire. This is, again, redundancy rule in play here. Two is one, one is none. I like, when it comes to things like fire, at least three or four different ways or different means to be able to start fire. A lighter is one of the simplest ways to do that. Having a lighter on hand, having a couple lighters on hand, I keep a few in my bag, is important. You're going to run out of fuel eventually. You can use them to barter with other people. You may run into some situation where somebody needs a form of heat and fire. You've got a lighter. You can trade that over with them for some other item or simply help them, which is not a bad thing to do either. Also, matches, waterproof matches. These are great. Nice little rubber gasket, a little bit of tinder in there. You've got a set of waterproof matches in a little case here, a little strike plate on the outside to light the match up. Then we've got good old-fashioned flint and steel or ferro rods. These are good, obviously, fire off some sparks and get yourself going. In addition to that, you want to have some tinder for this. Now, tinder can come in a variety of ways. You can get little leaves, little twigs, things of that nature. Lint from a dryer works well. Some people will take lint from a dryer, put it in a little baggie, and keep it in their bag. Other people will purchase from the store little tinder they're kind of like wicks, you know. You can tear these apart, break these up, and they're coated with a slight petroleum in there. The spark hits it and it lights it on fire. One of the simplest ways to do this is take cotton balls, put some Vaseline in a baggie, put the cotton balls in there, kind of squish it up there, get the cotton balls kind of soaked up in that Vaseline. One of these little guys will burn for 2 to 3 minutes. They light very quickly as well. You want to spread it apart a little bit, get the fibers exposed, so when those sparks hit it, lights it right up. Now, along with the fire or heat, another part of shelter that we didn't mention earlier would be things like stocking cap, having an extra stocking cap or one in your bag, extra socks. Wool socks are great, especially for wicking purposes. And something like this, again, depending upon your geographical location, just a simple face mask that protects you from the elements. These types of items, people don't think about very often, but if you're in a crisis situation and you've got a hike in a snowstorm and you do not have face protection, you don't have covering over your face, your whole world can be turned upside down. So having extra socks, something to keep your head warm, something to cover your face, protect your face, is an excellent and very important thing to have in your bug out go bag, again, depending upon your geographical location. Also, I didn't mention this, but I want to throw this in here now, is the footwear that you have. If you've got to hike any kind of a distance, walk any kind of a distance, you're not probably going to put shoes in your bug out bag, your go bag, but you should have them in your vehicle. Hiking boots or some kind of shoe that you can walk long distances in comfortably. One of the most important things you have to understand in a crisis survival type situation is mobility, being able to move. Light is critical. Light is essential. If you're in the dark and you can't see, again, you can't move very fast. We talk about mobility. We talk about being able to move quickly in a crisis. If you've got to get somewhere fast, get off the X fast, you've got to hustle, you need to be able to see where you're going. Now, first thing I always recommend, I carry with me all the time, is a tactical flashlight. Tactical flashlight, having that with you at all times is a very, very good thing to have. Now, a lot of people aren't going to carry this though. Women, you can carry it in your purse. Men, not too tough to just clip this in your pocket somewhere. Now, in your bag, I highly recommend you have a variety of means to light the way. I've got here a little crank and solar powered light. These are great little lights, right? You crank them up, you hit the switch, and you're gonna have some light there. The longer you crank it, the more power it generates. This also has a radio on it, which is also, for obvious reasons, a good thing to have. In addition to that, I always have a couple extra sources of light in my bag. In addition to my tactical flashlight that I carry, I keep extra flashlights in my bag, and I carry a headlamp. Also, very good to have in case you need hands-free, you've got other items to carry, you've got maybe a child to carry, maybe you're wounded and injured in some way and you've got an arm or a hand that's out of commission, now you've got only one hand to use. If you have light on the head with a headlamp, you're in a much better situation. When it comes to your lanterns and your flashlights, I recommend this too. Take the battery out and flip it the other direction and close it back up if you're not going to use it for a while. In your headlamp, you're going to have normally 2 or 3 small batteries, AA's or AAA's, in the headlamp. Take one of those and just reverse it. The reason is, if it's in your bag and the button gets hit and that light goes on and you don't know it, you're going to drain that battery and then you're done. So flipping the battery around keeps you from draining the battery accidentally. Now you're in much better shape if you get in a situation where you need that light. In addition, not a bad idea to carry extra batteries with you. Carry enough to cover your flashlight, your headlamp, maybe 2-3 times over. So if you've got 3 AAA's in your headlamp, make sure you bring in at least 3, if not 6 or 9 extra AAA batteries. And don't forget, we do have a link in the description below to get a checklist of everything that we're talking about here. Water, 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 water. I cannot emphasize water enough. The average person needs approximately 1 gallon of water a day. Now, some will say that that is about 1/2 gallon of drinking and 1/2 gallon for cleaning and cooking and so forth. I don't think you want to bargain with bare minimum when it comes to water, though. You don't know what exertion you're going to have to be putting out. If you're hiking, if you're carrying things, if you're carrying people, you got a child of some sort, you're putting out exertion, you may need more than a bare minimum of 1/2 gallon to 1 gallon of water. You need good access to clean water. I emphasize clean. Many people can get very sick. You can get very sick. You can die within a matter of days with different types of bacteria and viruses that you can take in through dirty water. So having clean water with you, on you, or access to clean water, ability to get clean water, is important. With that being said, I carry a couple bottles of water with me normally. I trade them out, change them out over time, but I will keep water with me in my bag so I've got something to get started with. In addition to that though, I keep a Sawyer Mini water filter. I like the Sawyer Minis. They're very effective. This one is rated to cover up to 100,000 gallons of water. That's a long time. You're not going to use that up, I'm sure, in most any situation. It also comes, this particular one comes with a little bag. You can fill the water up, keep it with you, transport it. You got a syringe for washing out the filter, and for other things you might need a syringe for in medical situations, whatever it may be, a good syringe is always good to have around. But again, having these types of items is critical. In addition to using a water filter to purify your water, you can always boil it. You can boil the water, or you can use water purification tablets in the water. Now, if you're going to use tablets, obviously you're introducing chemicals into the water, so preferred would probably be to keep yourself healthier and stronger using a filter or boiling the water. Now, water's heavy. It adds up. For those who might be thinking, I'm just going to carry extra water with me, you want to carry some, that's fine, but just know this, that to carry a gallon of water, which for one person is estimated a day's worth of water, especially under exertion, and it might be more than a gallon, that's going to add up. You're going to find that pretty taxing over time. So instead of just thinking I'm going to carry a lot of water with me, a bottle, not a big deal. If it's a short distance, I'm covered. But if I've got a long distance or I'm out for a long period of time, the duration is longer, having water filter with me is ideal. It's lightweight and it allows me to accomplish one of the most important things that I can have on hand in any crisis like this, and that is access to good, clean water. Now, calories are important. You need to have calories to keep moving. That's an obvious one. Again, you can live longer without food, roughly 3 weeks. Now, you're going to get sick. You're going to start feeling lightheaded. You're not going to function very well if you go even several days without food. It's going to wear and tear. We know this. Water, as we mentioned, far more critical. You got 3 days approximately without water, you could be dead. But food, we do want to consider. What are we going to do for food, for calories, to keep us strong, keep us moving forward? Variety of things you can do. Something like beef jerky, easy to pack, easy to carry with you. Granola bars, protein bars, very simple, easy ways to keep some calories, some protein, and so forth, close at hand, ready to go. You can also go with freeze-dried food. These little pouches work well. They're freeze-dried. This is freeze-dried beef. I got blueberries in this one right here. I can heat up the water. I can rip the bag off in the top. I can pour the water in the bag, stir it up, and I've got a meal. Now, consider this, though. If you go with freeze-dried food, you need preparation extras. In other words, you're gonna need some heat, you're gonna need to heat that water up, you need a container to heat the water in, that's gonna add time, that's gonna add weight, that's gonna add like a container to cook the food in, and of course, access to water to be able to do that. If you've got access to those things, this is a great option because a nice warm meal, some freeze-dried food with some water mixed in, and there's so many great brands out there, so many great tasting ones out there now, that you can actually set yourself up in a pretty good situation if you need that. But again, takes more time, takes more energy to put that together. Beef jerky, granola bars, protein bars, simple, quick, easy to accomplish getting those calories in and keep you moving forward. Now, we address this in much more detail through our Battle Ready Emergency Preparedness course, BREP for short. You can check that out in the description. This course gives you much more information than what we're giving you right now. God bless you and strengthen you for the fight. Look forward to seeing you again soon.